Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents He Who Breaks the Earth by Caitlin Sangster. Narrated by Kristin James. Chapter 1. Sweet Rolls to Die For. When Mateo stepped out of his room at the inn, all he could feel was death. It was a scent coming off the scuffed wooden walls, from beneath the floorboards with their threadbare carpet runners. Death was a shadow in the chatter of servants emerging from their rooms, and a sour note in the scent of honey and cream-filled sweet rolls coming from the kitchen. He took a deep breath, as if he could latch on to the fleeing details of the world where he was alive instead of slowly rotting away into nothing. If he ignored it, maybe it would go away. His father had always made the nothing go away before.
"I'm not going away," the nothing said. "I only just found you."
Mateo started down the hallway, his humors churning with discomfort at the hollow voice. The nothing hadn't always spoken to him. It had started with a hiss just after he'd woken up in the carriage with his father, the dust of Patanga's collapsed tomb still on his coat. Now, even walking down the inn's narrow hallway felt as if he were trapped in a spotlight on a stage, hundreds of little eyes peering up at him from a darkness that had gnawed at his humors, his muscle and bone. Mateo had always believed that slow drain of energy had been wasting sickness burning through his aura. But now he couldn't unknow. It was a thing, a nothing that was suddenly aware of him, watching him, occasionally commenting on his choice of dress, and pushing energy toward him instead of sucking it away, lacing the air around him with rot. Mateo wasn't sure it was a fair exchange if it meant he was already dead. Mateo's toe caught on the stained rug just before he got to the stairs, almost sending him down them head first. Heart racing, he blinked at the narrow passage, harsh beams of morning light touching each stair he would have hit. His knees on that second stair, then his head and neck on the fourth, his spine on the tenth, as if the light itself wanted to break him into little pieces. Calsta, the sky goddess, set on destroying an abomination. Chin thrust forward, he started down, shrugging off the light as it washed over him. A month before, Mateo had been at the edge of a new beginning, a new life to replace the one that had been gnawed to pieces. He and his father had finally located an undisturbed shapeshifter tomb with the basest-made healing compound, Capranum, sitting at the bottom, just waiting to heal the wasting disease that plagued him and half the warlords devoted. They'd dug and dug, dodged traps, lost workers. Then his father had introduced him to Leah. Mateo had brought her down into the tomb with them the night they'd broken into the shapeshifter's burial chamber to get the Capranum, which turned out to be the shapeshifter's very own sword.
"Are you stomping?" the voice asked. "Did the stairs do something to you, or are you always this delightful?"
Mateo caught himself stepping lightly onto the last stair, then made himself stomp the rest of the way to the kitchen, reveling in the feel of energy bursting inside him, then disgusted with himself because now he knew where the energy came from. He slammed open the kitchen door, the last barrier between him and the heavenly sense of Hilaria's cooking, and couldn't stop his mind ranging out to touch the bits of metal and stone in the room, like even more potential energy just waiting for his signal. For the first time, using his power like this didn't make him dizzy. He didn't stumble, didn't faint. His feet were there, squarely in the world, and suddenly nothing could stop him from doing what he liked. Not even the hole inside him come to life.
"I'm not a hole," the voice whispered.
And I wasn't going to stop you eating your weight in sugar anyway.
Even the sweet rolls smelled like decay. Mateo gave the maid a dignified nod, then grabbed a plate from the rack of dishes she'd been drying, surprised when she gave a perturbed squeak and jumped out of his way. As if somehow, for the first time in his life, he was someone to be wary of.
I'm so sorry. I didn't mean to frighten you.
He gave her a flourishing little bow that would have made Leah smirk at him.
No, of course not, sir.
The maid shrank back against the wall, keeping one eye on him even as she continued drying dishes. Mateo carefully checked the wide kitchen for Hilaria before stepping in any farther and only found raw fowl trussed and ready to be roasted on the wood-topped island at the center, the back counters filled with vegetables and roots for stew. Hilaria's tray of sweet rolls was shoved onto the counter just by the door out to the stables, topped with snowy cream and glistening with raspberry glaze. Mateo slid two sweet rolls onto his plate. Just as he began to lick his fingers, the door swung open and whacked him in the back of the legs.
Mateo Montagna, you interfolen!
Hilaria was on him before he could run for the stairs, the maid blocking the door with both hands clamped over her mouth, looking between him and the terror Hilaria had probably made of her life for the 2 days their party had been camped at the inn. Hilaria swatted at Mateo's plate, knocking one of the sweet rolls back onto the tray, narrowly missing his shoulder.
You get your grubby hands away!
Mateo ducked the next swat, pushing past her through the courtyard door, gratified that he'd managed to keep hold of the one sweet roll. Hilaria's food was to die for, but sometimes it seemed as if death was the only payment she'd accept for consuming it. Once he made it through the door, Mateo snaked into the hubbub of servants carrying trunks, saddling horses, and hitching wagons and carriages. He ducked behind their head hostler, Harlan, even as Hilaria shouted from the kitchen door. Harlan cleared his throat, pushing Mateo down an inch lower as he scanned the organized mess with an absurdly casual air, as if he weren't trying to hide a young man and his stolen raspberry cream behind his spindly legs.
She's going to gut you one of these days,
the old hostler murmured once Hilaria had shouted her way across the courtyard, letting Mateo stand up.
But not today if you get into the carriage quick. You'd think she'd be flattered.
Mateo lifted the roll to his mouth to take another bite, freezing when he caught sight of a small carriage out front, the door hanging open. A shock of coppery hair showed through the window, the occupant arguing loudly with the servant trying to close her inside.
Where's the other carriage, Harlan?
Harlan's face didn't change, a little too close to read.
Master Montagna sent it on ahead of us the day we got here. Didn't you notice?
Mateo swore, shoving another bite into his mouth and looking around for a place to hide. His stomach lurched as he looked down at his coat, the lacy front dribbled all over with glaze, the bright raspberry red dripping from his buttons like blood. There had been a lot of blood down in the tomb, all from that boy on the ground, a sword in his gut, impaled just the way the shapeshifter skeleton had been.
Knox, the voice hissed.
A sword just like the one they'd stolen from the tomb that Tool had bundled up and dragged behind his carriage in its own special wagon. A sword that was supposed to save Mateo's life. Mateo wasn't sure why the Capranum sword they'd stolen from Patanga's tomb needed the whole wagon to itself, but Tool had kept him and everyone else in their company from peeking under the tarp, as if touching the sword before the right time would ruin everything. But his father couldn't expect him to share a carriage with Arya Saystone. She was just like Leah, only smaller and slightly less good at violence. Mateo shoved the last of the roll into his mouth, icing dribbling down his lip.
Saddle Bella for me, would you?
he mumbled to Harlan around the lump of pastry. Tuol appeared at the inn's main doors, his sun hat tipped. He was all smiles and banter as he crossed to check under the tarp covering the wagon where the shapeshifter sword was. Once he'd resecured the canvas, Tuol walked toward the little carriage, Arya growling insults from inside. Mateo ducked down even farther, his stomach swirling with bile.
Riding alone probably isn't the best option.
Harlan was still talking, and Mateo hadn't heard a word.
Didn't they tell you about the attacks, boy? That's why we stayed at the inn for 2 days, despite your father being in a fury to get home. Even he couldn't brush off finding bodies in the road. Bodies?
Mateo turned to look at the hostler, only to catch sight of Hilaria storming from the kitchen yet again, both her fists clenched around the tray of sweet rolls to offer to the company. She made straight for Tuol, despite servants grabbing at the tray left and right, and presented him with the last one, which Tuol took with a bow, then handed it in to the carriage's single occupant.
It flew back out quick enough, landing in the dirt at Hilaria's feet.
Mateo cleared his throat, turning back to Harlan, vaguely horrified about the waste of a coveted sweet roll.
What do you mean they've been finding bodies?
His mind flicked back to the terrifying girl who'd been at the bottom of Patanga's tomb, the one who'd made vines burst out of the earth and grasp at him like snakes. Had she managed to follow them somehow? Father had said she might.
The first night it was, well, a devoted of all things, on the road.
Something killed a devoted? Mateo paused.
Yes, completely white and shriveled he was, like he'd been drained of blood. And there were bites.
Harlan looked down.
We thought it was a coincidence coming across him on the road, but then we started seeing animals in a similar condition near the camp. And then last night...
Last night what? Mateo leaned forward.
Well, Master Montagna is getting us out quick enough, but it won't bring back the kitchen boy.
Mateo's chest clenched a hair tighter. He looked just beyond the inn, out into the dense wall of foliage, the road cutting through it like a wound. They'd be safe soon. They'd be back at home where no one could get to them. No one except Leah, who would stop at nothing to get her sister. A shudder trilled down his back. Leah Saystone was not above killing. The Baildon girl he'd seen at the dig wouldn't be either. Mateo's mind flashed again to the shadowy figure in the tomb, energy singing like poison in the air around her, Tuol answering with a terrible magic that stank of murder. No. Mateo's jaw clenched. No, she isn't my sister, and I'm not.
You're not what? The little voice sang. You're not like your father, the one person who loved you before I found you. If you weren't like him, then you'd be dead.
Dead. The thought echoed in his head. He hadn't chosen to turn shapeshifter. He hadn't wanted it. Didn't want it now. But that couldn't change the sacrifice Tuol had helped him make, killing an innocent girl to save his own life, even if it had made him into a monster. Mateo breathed the word in and then out again. People were the choices they made, not the labels other people gave them. He was what he was. He was alive. And he would make do with what life he had left. No one could fault him that.
Are you all right?
Harlan's voice was concerned. Mateo looked down to find the plate in shards between his two hands, blood on his fingers. He dropped the broken pieces like a dead snake, recoiling back a step. Hilaria was very animatedly speaking to his father by the carriage,
and the barely contained glee on Tool's face made Mateo fairly certain that it had to do with a stolen sweet roll. His father turned a fraction and caught Mateo's eye across the courtyard, a guffaw so painfully held in that Mateo knew Tool would be cackling about it later. He'd thought his father had finally decided to be open with him, to stop keeping secrets. How could Tool have known about these killings and not told him?
Mateo?
Harlan was still standing there, worried.
I'm fine.
Mateo wiped his bloody fingers on his coat, flinching when red smeared across the fabric to match the raspberry. This coat had been his favorite back at the university. Just the right number of ruffles to be interesting without being too much. The shade of green perfectly complementing his light brown skin. He started toward the stable, Harlan twitching along behind him as if he'd been attached with a string.
I'm going to ride, Harlan. Nothing is going to attack us in broad daylight.
They look almost like Arosh kills,
Harlan murmured. Mateo's stomach roiled, the sweet roll threatening to come back up.
With the first body being a devoted and... Well, I think we both know Arosh's don't roam free this far south. Honestly, I'm surprised we don't hear more tales of those monsters killing their riders. If you are determined to take Bella, keep your eyes open. There could be more of them following us.
Devoted or feral Arosh's?
Either.
Harlan shrugged. Mateo turned toward the open stable doors. It wasn't the warlord he was worried about. She would at least try to talk to them before gutting him. The warlord thought they had something she wanted, a cure to wasting sickness. Arosh kills and dead devoted on the road seemed more like Leah with her foul steed prowling after them. It wasn't enough that her actual job, magical calling, God's given purpose in the world was to kill people like Mateo and his father. Tool had gone and kidnapped her younger sister.
Because he wants me to live.
The words unspooled inside him, his own this time.
I want to live.
Mateo strode into the light-starved stables, straight for Bella's stall. She gave an excited whinny when she saw him. He ran a hand down her neck, grateful when she buried her nose in his chest. His heart slowed a beat. But only the one. If the kills out there weren't Leah's doing, he'd eat his own oversized sun hat. A sick feeling of betrayal welled deep in his chest. Tool had blackmailed her into an engagement, encouraging Mateo to get to know her, to give her a chance. And Mateo had accidentally done it. He'd talked to her, almost been killed with her, stolen an Arosh with her. Saved her from the warlord. And then he'd thought that maybe he'd wanted to, he'd even thought that she might want that someone could see past the many deaths of Mateo Montaña to him had always been an impossible thing until that day in his father's office with Leah. She'd stayed. She'd talked to him. She'd listened. She was smart. She was funny. She was beautiful. She was exactly what he... Mateo forced the thought of Leah's burnished hair, her freckles, her blue eyes from his mind, turning to take the saddle from a hostler and place it on Bella's back. The maybes that surrounded Leah had been so new and unexpected and hopeful that they'd felt forbidden, secret, delicious. But then she'd seen the reliefs in Patenga's tomb the same moment he had. She'd been Tool's plan all along. Leah plus a Capranum sword. All magic required sacrifice, and the sacrifice that had made Mateo into the creature he was had been botched, tearing a hole inside him instead of filling him to the brim with power. The magical Capranum he'd been searching for with his father for years was just the vessel. The knife, the sword, the axe, to seal the sacrifice of the person you loved most. Because that's what Mateo needed to survive. A new sacrifice to replace the old one that hadn't worked. It put him in a difficult place. How could he fall in love with Leah Saystone knowing it was all to keep his own heart beating at the expense of hers? And how could he persuade her to love him back as the oaths required when she now knew exactly what the end would look like for her? Dead on the end of a shapeshifter sword. But without Leah, Mateo would continue to die bit by bit from the hole the transformation had left inside him. A hole that had to be filled with something. Someone. All magic came from sacrifice. It was only in the last month that he understood it was sacrificed love. A love realized, bonded, solidified, then torn asunder, that could make something as powerful as a shapeshifter. And if Mateo wanted to live, he had to make that sacrifice himself, the right way. Mateo finished pulling the buckles tight and stood. Leah would come, but it wouldn't be with an open heart. Maybe she'd already gone back to the warlord and would come across an entire devoted army.
"She's not with the warlord," the little voice giggled. "She's with your sister."
Halfway to sticking his foot in the stirrup, Mateo faltered, falling forward. Bella snorted, her head twisting back to look at him reproachfully.
"Leah's with... are you sure?"
"I think they formed the first official I Hate Mateo Montagna Club."
Mateo's insides went cold.
"Gods above, couldn't you have said something earlier?"
"Why does Leah scare you so much?"
it said, ignoring his question.
"Leah Saystone is just a girl. She's made of muscles and energy and toenails and hair, and worms will eat her face just as quickly as they would anyone else's, as fast as they would have eaten you if I hadn't been there."
"I didn't ask for my father to make me kill you," he thought furiously at the nothing, but then turned the fury back on himself for engaging with it at all.
"I'm not nothing, and I'm not an it," the little voice hissed,
and Mateo could feel the shape of her underneath the helpless whisper she'd been using with him, like a monstrous mass of sinew, bone, and claws flexing from behind its little girl mask.
"My name is Willow. And if you knew what's good for you, you'd be worrying more about the other one."
Her voice broke.
"Knox never would let me have her, even when I starved. She would have fixed everything, but she ruined it instead."
"I am worried about the other one."
Mateo mounted Bella and steered her out into the courtyard, past the little carriage, the wagons, the life that had been so kind to him these last 8 years. Running from the one he'd forgotten. Tool had told him in the carriage as they'd ridden away from the tomb that his sister had spent her whole life looking for him. But even if that were true, how had Willow known? Mateo cleared his throat, kicking Bella even faster, pushing the name away. The thing in his head didn't get a name. It didn't exist.
"I'm so hungry,"
Willow sighed. Her voice quieted, shriveling down to almost nothing.
"You're hungry too, so you know how it feels. You'll feed me, won't you, Mateo?"
Mateo shivered at the sound of his name made from thorns and ice, because he did know how that hunger felt. He did want to live. And nothing was going to stop him. Not Hilaria and her sweet rolls. Not blood in the cuts on his hands. Not Arya Saystone swearing when she thought people could see her and sobbing into her pillow when she thought they couldn't. Not his sister, whatever monstrous thing she'd become. Not Leah and her red curls, her Arosh, and her sword.
If I tell you more about what they're doing, will you stop calling me a thing?
Willow asked. But Mateo couldn't let himself listen to a ghost. Who even knew why she was inside him, what she wanted, and what she'd take from him? Because that's all people ever did. Take. Keeping his eyes open for the rocky formations that marked the hidden path to the caves that would take him home, Mateo kicked Bella out onto the road, thinking only of the wind in his hair and the sun on his face because it was touching him, making him as real, as important, as alive as anyone else in the company, no matter the scent of death in his nose. He wanted to live. Chapter 2. An Indecent Portrait. Noah sat back in the wagon with her eyes closed, glad for the sun on her face. She could feel Alton watching her as the wagon lurched across the street toward Castor's Temple, the heckle and cry of Rentara's university district louder than any kind of applause. People were always louder when they were angry than when they were happy. Everyone in this city was angry. Not as angry as Anwei, though Noah's friend hid it inside the carefully formed mask she'd made of her face. Not as angry as Leah, back at the camp sharpening her sword. But angry enough, as if every person on the road had looked out their window that morning and decided everything was going to go wrong. It made Noah want to do a handstand on the box board, somersault down, and ignite her fire tethers in a fiery swirl. Maybe that would be enough to make one person in this city smile. That's what Noah was good at, making people smile. Anwei hadn't let her bring the fire tethers, though. Something about sneaking into a library not meshing well with flame. She'd had that awful mask of a smile on her face when she said it, too, almost as if she thought fooling Noah would be as easy as fooling everyone else.
Are you going to help me brace this thing, or are you just here to keep the wagon from blowing away?
Alton called from the other side of the wagon.
I thought that was why you brought that lizard with you everywhere.
Cracking one eye open to look at the trib, Noah got a full view of his fire key lizard instead, the little creature glaring at her from where its blunt nose stuck out from the back of Alton's collar. Noah closed her eyes again, relishing the way Alton's gaze just sank in deeper, as if he couldn't look away. Maybe it wasn't just making people smile she was good at. Catching people's attention wasn't hard. All it took was a little surprise, a little sparkle. Keeping attention required real talent.
Isn't gallery supposed to help you with all the little things you can't do yourself? She asked.
Unfortunately, gallery isn't up to keeping 50 pounds of indecent stained glass portrait upright in this traffic.
Alton braced himself when the wagon jerked to a halt, Anwei swearing from the driver's bench.
She's better at burning people when they annoy me.
He thinks I'm trying to annoy him, Noah said in a lantern to Anwei's back.
The bright crimson scarf she'd helped tie over the healer's long braids, flapping in the wind like a flag. Alton's long tail of hair with the short bits in the front was covered too, both of them styled to look like artists. Hopefully the kind no one looked at twice because their scarves weren't knotted or braided to show rank. A bailed-in healer and a trib rider carrying a heavy load into Castor's Temple like drudges would have caught a few too many eyes.
You think I should show him what it looks like when I'm actually trying to annoy someone? A show I'd love to see, but it'll be hard to deliver that thing to the temple if it breaks in half on the way.
Anwei called back in Noah's own language, the words bittersweet in Noah's ears. Noah missed the Alantan docks, the smell of the southern sea, the playhouses and the people who played in them. Though she didn't relish the thought of joining one now. It would just be an excuse to get out of a life that expected nothing of her except a good marriage and obedience. It was as if she was nothing more than a portrait herself,
shrouded until someone impressive enough asked to admire her. Noah raised a hand to look at her extended fingers. She looked much better out here in the sunlight.
You can't just tell me I'm handsome in words I understand? Alton asked.
I wanted to pretend we were Unrealthasen.
Noah sighed, leaning in to brace the portrait when the wagon lurched forward once again.
I swear she can speak common. She just won't, Alton laughed. I could start using only Trib, and then none of us would understand each other.
I'd understand you, Anwei shot back, swearing when a Silenbok swung its tail just ahead of her, making their horse dance.
Alton's horse, really. Most of what they had was Alton's.
She's saying she wanted to sneak into the Scholar God's sky-cursed library as fire dancers. Don't help him, Anwei, Noah grinned. He needs to learn he doesn't know everything.
Really? Fire dancing?
Alton peered at her from around the side of the ridiculous portrait.
I'd pay to see that.
You wouldn't get to watch. Anwei only convinced me to deliver this glass in place of the special window the first scholar ordered because we know how bad you are at dancing.
I am not bad at dancing.
You are holding the glass, right, Noah? Because we're...
Anwei's voice cut off when a horse reared directly in front of them. Noah wrinkled her nose, bracing the shrouded glass pane tight against its ties. Over the top of the wagon sides, the temple facade of 13 white columns stood out like jewels in an ebony frame, one of Castor's 13 moon phases carved into each. Together, the columns made a sunburst that centered on the building's front steps, the entrance itself populated with a crowd of wrinkled acolytes in blue robes chanting about Castor's unending fight to rule the night sky. Why scholars chose such drab apparel, Noah would never know. Even the scholar god, Castor himself, knew how to put on a show, the moon a riot of blues and purples as he crossed the sky and danced with his brother moon, Jaxum. The scholars chanting on the steps looked, at best, very comfortable. When Anwei turned the wagon down the little service road to the side of the temple, Noah eagerly looked past her to the university compound beyond it. She'd always wanted to come and study in Rentara, but her father had said suitors in such places wanted more than a girl who knew how to shine and that she wasn't suited to do anything else. The sight of the building sprawled past Jaxum's temple had walls of warped glass, all the different gods' halls like squat little frogs getting ready to do battle, with students scurrying between them like ants. Noah sighed and looked away. It wasn't that her father was correct. She could do more than shine. But the buildings here didn't look so different from the university in Cheol, and everyone there had seemed to agree with her father about what Noah should do with herself. Jaxum's temple rose a full story above Castor's, blocking the scholar god's view of the rest of the temples. Trying to needle his brother, as usual. There were devotees on Jaxum's steps shouting back at the ones praising Castor, a war of words and wrinkles. Noah touched Phelan's flower in her hair, grateful her own goddess was much more amenable to fun. She could feel the goddess like a hand on her shoulder, Phelan eager to see their mischief.
Why are all these old people out chanting at one another?
Starfall last month. Remember, right before we left Cheol? Anwei didn't look back, pulling the horse to a halt and tying the reins to her bench.
They're still yelling about who lost the battle. I'm going to say it was us, since we have to listen to this racket.
Noah stood, waiting until Alton had undone the tethers holding the frame on his side before she knelt to untie the ones on hers. It felt like years, not weeks, since the two moons had gone to war in the night sky, their arrows darting as flashes of light. She'd been standing on the governor's balcony, the boy to whom her father had deeded her face down in his soup. Anwei had given her the herbs to put Bear to sleep, to fight her own war in a swirl of light and fire, just like the moons in the sky. And it had been that moment she'd seen the way out. Noah had spent her life wrenching at the strings her father had fastened to her wrists and ankles, an unruly marionette that danced where she liked, until her father handed the controller to someone new. Bear wasn't so controlling, but his father, the governor, had thoughts about what his son's prospective wife should or shouldn't be doing. Wearing, saying, being. So, the night Anwei had invited Noah to help haunt the governor's ballroom, nothing but little sparks of fire and some scary voices. Noah hadn't minded when things escalated after she set fire to the governor's prized Palatian drapes. It was slightly less amusing when the governor barred all the gates and locked her up right when Noah was supposed to be helping Anwei get out of the compound safely. It wasn't until Noah overheard the governor yelling at his steward that she'd realized he hadn't locked the compound gates with all his guests still inside because of some burned drapes. A book had gone missing from his study. The lock jimmied, guards found collapsed on the floor. The servant searched every guest, every servant, every hostler, every Arosh in the stables, probably. But somehow, despite the fact that Noah had seen Anwei on the ballroom floor right before the whole place had been shuttered, she and her little shadow friend Knox were nowhere to be found. Standing there in the window, watching the swirl of agitation Anwei had left in her wake, Noah had realized the dance Anwei was performing was something wholly different from what she'd thought. It was on some other stage, in another version of life Noah had never seen before. Anwei wasn't even dancing. She was the puppeteer, twitching people this way and that until she got her way. So Noah had climbed out the window to join her, which had led to helping Anwei set a shapeshifter excavation site on fire right in front of the sky-cursed warlord herself. Hiding in a sugarcane field, shaking as the Arosh calls came closer and closer, the ground rumbling under her feet and devoted scampering in the other direction like scared little children. Away from the tomb, as if it weren't the warlord's job to ensure the shapeshifter down in that hole stayed dead. All except one devoted had run. Noah's mouth twisted at the thought of him and what had happened to him. She wouldn't take back any of what she'd done for a single coin from her father, because out here, the thing she did mattered to her and to everyone else.
You've got your side?
Alton's voice brought her back to the cobblestones. He peeked over the top of the glass, a smile still plastered across his face. Alton always smiled. It made Noah wonder what was beneath it.
I don't carry anything that weighs more than I do.
Noah stood up, stepping back from the glass.
My face would turn red, and my job is to be distracting in a good way.
He shook his head, laughing, and Noah looked away, worried there wasn't anything underneath his smile at all. That he was exactly what he looked like from the outside. A rich boy who had found a new and interesting place to spend his coin. Boys like that could be entertaining for days at a time, sometimes even weeks. Until they weren't anymore. Because, in her experience, rich boys cared for nothing but what they wanted next. Noah hopped out of the wagon, making room for Anwei to help Alton slide the ungainly thing toward the wagon's lip. Patting the two loops of hair knotted just above her ear, Anwei had threaded them with gold before they left camp that morning. Noah walked up to the gate where the guard was staring curiously at them through the wrought iron bars.
Would you please open this?
She gave the bars a slightly exasperated rattle.
You were supposed to be ready for us. Oh, and we'll need one of you to help carry the ladder and tools, of course.
This gate is meant for gardeners.
The guard cleared his throat, his eyes brushing the two knots that marked Noah as second Conan, then jumping down to the gold and crimson embroidery coiling up her skirt.
Which you clearly are not. How may I help you?
Gods above and below, Noah moaned. They didn't tell you to expect us. The first scholar herself ordered this piece.
She gestured dramatically toward the shrouded glass Alton and Anwei were sliding off the wagon bed.
She came to me. I promised her on my mother's life that I'd find something suitably dramatic and yet subtle for her study.
Drawing herself up, Noah gave the gate a rattle.
This is the only way to get such a large piece of art into the building without breaking it. And frankly, you are in our way. Open this gate immediately.
The guard backed up a few steps, gesturing toward the main building.
I'll just check.
Priceless art, commissioned by the first herself.
Noah gave the glass an aggravated flick as Alton drew up next to her, huffing. His arms looked quite nice in his trib vest. They never saw the need to wear shirts under those things, which made sense because it was hot.
And it's heavy. One slip and 6 months of painstaking work.
She slapped her hands together with a flourish.
The first has been waiting most impatiently to see this masterpiece I've created for her, and I don't like to think what could happen if we're made to stand out here a moment longer.
Noah refrained from batting her eyes prettily. Anwei had advised against smiles, since scholars at Castor's Temple were much more likely to be moved by fear of politics rather than long eyelashes. A role she didn't usually play, but Noah didn't mind pretending to be a doltish rich lady. She'd done it often enough back in Cheol.
Perhaps you might tell me your name so I can bring it to the first's attention once we are finally allowed to deliver this one-of-a-kind, highly valuable, extremely fragile.
Fine.
The guard extracted a set of wrought iron keys from his coat pocket and jammed the largest of them into the lock. Anwei had brought Noah with her to scout the temple grounds 2 nights before to identify the entrances that would allow them to pass the fewest number of guards before they made it inside the temple itself. Normally, she said, they'd have snuck in at night, but according to her contact at the university, the scholars of Castor's Great Library doubled the guard at night and were more likely to be present at their desks and in the stacks during those dark hours. That wouldn't have been a terrible hurdle, except that the restricted collections underground were locked up with iron and chain, 3 guards at each door. Since the underground collections were where they needed to go, Anwei had opted for something less stealthy. Luckily, the first scholar's real window was set to be delivered that very morning. Even more luckily, it had broken the night before due to an unfortunate incident with the apprentice glazier, 2 knuckles of malt, and a dropped hammer. Noah had been the one who dropped the hammer. The apprentice was probably waking up now, remembering nothing but the girl he'd met at the malt house. Not how the priceless work of art his master had only just finished had ended up in pieces on the shop floor. With any luck, he'd stew until the master glazier arrived after his mid-morning tea to deliver it to the Holy First. Just enough time for them to get inside and steal whatever it was Anwei wanted from the library's dusty old shelves. Something that would lead them to her snake-tooth man and the cursed sword he'd managed to lift right out from under them at the tomb. Tool Montagna, the shapeshifter. Prickles of excited horror bristled down Noah's arms at the thought. She gave the gate one last shake that sent it flying open and walked through. Watching Anwei with her puppet strings had been fascinating. Anwei was so wild and free, doing exactly as she pleased and getting everyone else to do as she pleased as well, almost like magic. But Tool Montagna was the same. Leah Saystone, too. They were all made from the things they wanted. They were people who acted, who did, and the whole world held its breath as they passed. And pass they did, leaving whole cities hanging askew. Each of them was running towards something, which was very different from running away. Noah had never been much good at anything more than making her father angry. She consoled herself that, at least on that front, she was probably doing rather well. But since running away, she'd found that defining herself as the dull ache behind her father's eyes seemed less and less meaningful. The guard gave Noah a slightly anemic bow as she walked into the compound, reaching to pull back the glass's shroud as Anwei and Alton passed. Anwei slapped his hand away just in time, the very picture of an artist lugging 6 months of work that she didn't mean to waste on someone who wouldn't appreciate it. You honestly believe I'll let you look at this masterpiece before the Holy First herself gets to see it? You'd be lucky to set your eyes on this even after it's put in place.
Right.
The guard gritted his teeth, turning back to Noah.
A ladder, you said?
And the tools, yes, thank you. They're in the wagon bed. Oh, and bring the wood for the armature, of course.
She started down the garden path, not bothering to look back at him. The side entrance to the temple was only 50 feet back from the gate, the guard standing there already prepared to block her way. But Noah was ready with the Honorable Master Glazier Finnelig Burstrom seal. Anwei had snagged it after Noah had broken the window the night before. They opened the doors just in time for Anwei to trip over the top step, so the glass swung wild again, Alton shuffling to the side with a groan. One of the guards darted forward to steady it. Caster's quills, Anwei swore, and Noah was impressed by the hint of tears in her friend's voice.
You heathen, Marcus. I might never hold a grozing iron again after shaping this piece, and you choose today to stumble?
Alton didn't bite back because Gallery had chosen that moment to scuttle down the back of his shirt. Noah slid between him and the guards to block the sight of his tunic moving all on its own, wondering what little lizard claws felt like skittering down his spine.
Can you believe these two? She whispered to the door guard, leaning a hair closer than was perhaps strictly necessary. Old habits. Perhaps you could escort us so they don't destroy my masterpiece before it's been installed.
The guard's smile in return was hesitant, bearing the temple's V house mark on his front canine.
I see there's a delivery scheduled from a Master Benedict later today. That's me.
Alton's voice sounded forced. He was a terrible actor and a terrible dancer.
The first will be waiting for us. This window is possibly the most beautiful thing I've ever created.
Noah lowered her voice.
Those two did the actual designing and cutting and painted the details and all that.
She flipped a hand toward Anwei and Alton, the latter of whom seemed to be actually shaking. Though if it were from laughter or strain from holding the glass window, Noah couldn't tell.
But the commission was mine. She sent two messengers just this morning to hurry us along, but I said, no, you cannot rush an artist. I haven't even had my breakfast.
The guard started to laugh, but then stopped himself, lowering his voice to match Noah's.
The first isn't even here.
His smile came a little more naturally, and he leaned forward a bit, and Noah knew she'd done the right thing. He undid the latch and propped the door open.
Given the circumstances, I suppose it's all right. I probably shouldn't let you in, but...
Oh, I agree. You probably shouldn't.
Noah kept her smile, wide and full of teeth, as she gestured for Alton and Anwei to come through.
But intelligent folk like you and me understand true urgency.
The temple's inside was all high ceilings and rows upon rows of bookshelves, the way into the main stacks blocked by a jeweled grate. They followed the guard up to the barrier, Noah letting him explain who they were to the woman in long scholar robes with a single Conan knot draped across her forehead. The scholar held a book in one hand, and the pinch between her eyebrows said that she'd rather be reading than conversing with real people.
The first isn't going to be here at all today, so any rubbish about messengers and fancy windows will not be tolerated.
She turned her glare on Noah.
I suppose she was supposed to pay you upon receipt? Scholars are not fool enough to fall for such a story, girl. I'd be willing to bet there's nothing under that packing but bare wood.
Bare wood?
Noah feigned shock. Something Anwei had made her do in front of a mirror for an hour before she'd been satisfied. The first being absent was an eventuality they'd been anticipating, seeing how Anwei had poisoned the woman's tea that very morning. Just enough to make her ill, of course.
It's so difficult to move, and every moment it's unmounted is a moment of risk.
She'd rehearsed this too with Anwei, liking the way it felt almost like a dance.
I'm not worried about being paid. True art transcends silver rounds.
Anwei made a good show of not agreeing.
Maybe it's better the first isn't here, Noah continued. We could install it now before she returns. It was designed for the space in her office, so where else should her first sight of it be but in that space? Just think, the reveal.
She put her hands up, looking toward the high ceiling.
The drama.
The old scholar was clearly trying very hard not to roll her eyes.
Fine, she said. If all you want is to leave that thing in her office, I can show you where to go. There will be no money, and you will not just be set free to roam the stacks. The time it will take to supervise this ridiculous scheme will set my precious studies back ages.
She closed her book with a disgusted sniff and gestured for them to follow her past the gates. The guard craned his neck to get a look under the glasses covering as Anwei and Alton passed, but it was tied tight. Thank the sky. Once they were through, the scholar led them down the aisles between shelves, bright beams of light coming from the blue-stained windows above to paint casters' faces on the floor. Past thousands of books, past the scholars copying old manuscripts onto new vellum and illuminating the margins, all the way to the grand staircase Anwei had marked on their map of the temple that would take them up to the first scholar's office. The staircase was quite long. Noah felt very positive about her choice not to carry anything during this particular performance. By the time they got to the upper landing, the guard carrying the ladder was red in the face, and Alton was sweating. The scholar went to a jeweled door, sunlight streaming through to cast a kaleidoscope of colors across the floor. Opening it, the scholar shooed them inside. Noah impressed by the imposing desk covered in books, a pane of glass behind it etched with Castor's moon so when the first sat there, it would frame her head like a corona. The scholar cast a sharp eye across the laced vellum tomes stacked neatly on the desk. Maybe this was an opportunity for the scholar as much as it was for them. Noah gave her a moment to examine the books and bound papers piled on the desk before clearing her throat.
Perhaps you could give my artists some space to work?
The scholar didn't even look up from inspecting the texts, wide-eyed with barely concealed awe as she picked one up.
I can't in good conscience leave you unattended, especially after the warlord herself defiled the lower stacks earlier this week.
Noah lurched toward her, grabbing hold of the scholar's arm and dragging her squawking from the room, the scholar clasping the book to her chest like a newborn child as if she expected Noah to wrench it from her hands. There was a reason Jaxum triumphed in every battle with Castor. Scholars might believe words were enough, but it didn't stop people from pushing them around. Noah grabbed hold of the guard by the door, barely giving him time to deposit the tools and ladder before pulling both of them out onto the landing.
Start with the hammer, Alton,
she called over her shoulder before letting it swing shut. She let go of the scholar, standing between her and the jeweled door. The guard looked with great uncertainty between the two of them.
Surely you, a seeker of knowledge, understand just how inappropriate it would be for you to see this window before the first does?
That is ridiculous, the scholar made to push past her, but Noah held her ground, maneuvering the old bat backward toward the stairs.
Perhaps this pride of yours is something I should speak to the first about when she returns? Or I could tell her the name of the book you stole from her office.
Noah snatched it away before the scholar could stop her.
Surviving reliefs that reference the nameless god. Interesting.
The guard gasped, both hands over his mouth. Noah held the book up.
This is what you take from the Holy First's office?
She wished this was the part where she could ignite her tethers, or the book, or something, and twirl in a circle of flame. Unfortunately, she was stuck with being judgmental, which was much less fun.
I didn't think such disrespect and blasphemy existed among Caster scholars.
I did not take it from her office. You took me from her office and... The guard looked as if he meant to cry. Shattering glass sounded from inside the office, and Noah's heart began to race, even as she blocked the scholar from pushing past her. She hadn't thought Alton would be able to bring himself to do it. Laughter bubbled up inside her, and Noah wanted to pull open the door to see what Alton looked like while defacing an ancient temple. But she had a job.
We all knew the old window would have to be broken. Old traditions are meant to be documented, remembered, but not kept on top of us, demanding we continue on. This is the beginning of something new.
But... The scholar's spindly fingers latched onto Noah's wrist, trying to wrench her out of the way.
I'm going to go assist.
Noah pulled free, tapping the book thoughtfully before turning back toward the door.
I'll have to think very carefully about what to say about what happened here to my Aunt Vesper.
Vesper. One of the hundreds of useless old women draped in gold and jewels with whom the first was quite chummy. The very name caused both the guard and the scholar to blanch. Noah opened the jeweled door.
Don't interrupt us, please. Creating something new is a holy thing, is it not?
She stepped through, pulling the door shut after her and setting the latch so it couldn't be opened from the outside. Alton was perched at the top of the ladder, his whole face screwed up in horror at the gaping hole where the moon had been etched into the glass. Anwei was nowhere to be seen.
Please tell me some god isn't going to smite me for this.
He reached up to tap at the glass with the hammer again, cringing when it cracked.
The scholar god will probably just have people write nasty things about you.
Noah began unwrapping the glass they'd brought.
Anwei found the way down?
Before the door even closed behind you.
Getting down to the restricted stacks was no easy feat when you didn't have a million keys hanging from your belt. Only scholars would think to use keys as some kind of status symbol. The Holy First, however, had a special stairway set aside just for her use that led directly to them, which was why they'd had to get rid of her, then break into her office. Alton finished cleaning out the last of the glass just in time to avert his eyes when Noah pulled away the last of the wrapping.
I'm afraid if I look at it again, it'll be stuck in my head for the rest of my life. When I fall asleep, all I'll be able to think of is...
The Chael shipping advisor missing his skivvies?
Noah shuddered as she looked over the glass, skillfully pieced together and painted with, perhaps... more detail than anyone could have wanted.
Where did Anwei come by that thing, anyway?
It was in the load we brought from Chael. I don't think she brought it on purpose, but apparently the shipping advisor paid her to steal it out of his mistress's apartment. She showed it off to some of the wrong people, I guess.
Noah opened the bag of tools they'd taken from the glazier's shop. It was full of sharp things and heavy metal-looking things and jars of liquidy things that looked quite poisonous. She pulled out a small mallet and turned to face the gap in the framing over the first's desk.
I guess he didn't pay the rest of his fee, so Anwei kept it. I think she's glad to give it the attention it deserves now.
You don't think Anwei actually wants us to put it up, do you?
We only brought the shipping advisor because they wouldn't have believed we were installing a window if we had no window.
But just think of the first expression when she sees it. A whole day's worth of appointments where she'll have to sit with the shipping advisor looking over her shoulder before they can get a glazier to remove him.
Noah took hold of the glass's frame and began dragging it toward the desk.
Anwei said we had at least 10 minutes before we had to get out. Don't be a drag. This will be fun.
Alton sighed, smiled. He always smiled. But then he picked up the other end, still averting his eyes.
I'm not sure fun is the right word.
Anwei stole down the stairs, pulling up the hood of the scholar robe she'd snagged from the first's office, and stuffed the key that had been under the false bottom in her desk's top drawer into her pocket. It was hard to keep herself from running, the black pall Knox made at the back of her mind freezing and stabbing at her in turn. The connection between them felt hot, warping the air around people walking by, as if suddenly she had a flicker of his devoted aura sight and a taste of his strength. Since saving him in the tomb, her sense of smell had blossomed larger, so even stones seemed to sing as she walked by, inviting her to touch it, when before it had only moodily acknowledged her existence. Herbs were what she knew. Now, with her aura all mixed together with Knox's, there was more. More to worry about, too. Although their minds were still connected, Knox had only come out of his sleep in fleeting moments since the snake-tooth man had stabbed him. Every day, Knox's presence seemed to wane. He tossed in his sleep, thrashed when she forced food and water down his throat. Anwei had barely managed to keep him alive. She bit her lip, ready to demand godly help, to poison, fight, steal, destroy, if it meant saving him. There had to be a way to bring him back. She just had to find it, like she'd found everything else she'd ever needed. But the snarl of ice and thorns that she felt in his mind worried her. She wasn't sure who he'd be if, when, he woke. He'd been a ghost when he fell, a ghost who had been trying to kill her. Anwei had reacted the way she always did, with her herbs. She'd thrown Calistet at him, the poison no one could recover from, without thinking. As soon as she'd done it, the energy coursing through her had blazed bright, golden and hot, worse than the panic of realizing Knox would die the moment it hit him. With that energy, Anwei had managed to grab hold of the Calistet with her mind mid-air to stop it from reaching him, all while wondering if she couldn't poison him, would he stab her? Then the snake-tooth man had arrived to stab a sword through Knox's gut since he hadn't taken enough from her yet. Everything after that was a singular blur of pain, light, fire, and roots writhing like snakes all, the whole world fading to nothing as she tried to heal Knox's terrible wound. The shapeshifter she'd been chasing for 8 years, the one who was supposed to have murdered her brother, had been there, right there within reach. And she'd let him go. It was hard not to stomp or yell or run at the memory, but Anwei had to stay focused. She'd told Noah and Alton they only had 10 minutes in the temple before they needed to retrieve the wagon and meet her 3 streets over. She didn't have time to start hyperventilating. Anwei reached the first floor a good 30 seconds ahead of schedule. The staircase led her out just behind the guards, keeping people from wandering into the restricted stacks. Moving quickly, Anwei walked down the hall as her contact at the university had told her to. The hallway would end in a door. Only it didn't. It turned a corner. Anwei slowed, taking in a breath. She smelled nothing but the dusty brown of aged vellum and old gray stone. No people. So she raced around the bend only to find a 2-story picture window, a very large, very cross-looking scholar glaring down at her in white and red glass. There was no door. Anwei's gut twisted. 10 minutes. She had already used 1.5 of them. Inhaling again, she caught braised lamb and roasted greens slipping through the layers of color, closely followed by dusty blue-gray cotton, sweat, and the clammy scent of ink. Anwei stared at the glass because the smells were somehow coming from inside it. After a moment, she walked straight toward it, bracing for her nose to hit glass. But it never did, because the picture was an optical illusion, the frame a doorway that lined up perfectly with the window at the far end of a hall. Leave it to scholars to try to trick people with their own minds. Once she was through the opening, Anwei turned past the glass toward wrought iron doors blocked by a dusty little scholar at a desk. They'd been following the snake-tooth man for weeks when he'd suddenly disappeared from the road, almost as if he'd crumbled to nothing, setting Anwei into a panic. Until she remembered so many years before when she'd tried to learn which family marked their servants with a snake. The scholars had written down her name that day. One had even scrawled a little picture of her, she'd thought, then told her the mark was associated with a specific estate. Only the last family to live there had died 75 years earlier in a fire. That there was nothing else worth sharing. And also to get her dirt-crusted hands away from his precious records. But his mouth had been tight as he said it. Extra care taken as he checked her name again, almost as if he was addressing a letter at that moment to tell the snake-tooth man someone had come looking for him. There was information here. Hidden. An address, perhaps. Maps? Maybe even plans of the house where the snake-tooth man had taken Leah's younger sister and Patanga's cursed sword. A house where her brother had. She strangled that thought. Her brother, who was not dead. Anwei fanned away the anger burning in her throat as she approached the desk. The scholar looked up from a very beautiful illustration of a tree he was embellishing with a little pot of gold paint.
"Do you need something?" he asked. "You have to have direct orders to get something from these shelves."
Nodding, Anwei pulled out a little bottle of malt from her bag, uncorked it, then held it out to the scholar. "Would you hold that, please?" He took it even as he protested.
"What is?"
"Hold still now." She extracted the wooden funnel from its place in the bag's side pocket and jammed it into the bottle's open mouth, then poured in a little stream of powder. Stowing the packet of powder and the funnel, she took the bottle back and corked it, giving it a good shake. Flashing a smile at the scholar who was staring at her open-mouthed, she shook the bottle one more time, waiting for the harsh citrine smell to turn to fiery red. Little splatters of powder had gotten on the book, the scholar staring at the page with horror. "Sorry." She tried to sound it, though she wasn't particularly. "A bit time-sensitive, this stuff. Thank you so much for your help." It wasn't changing. She swirled the bottle around again, anger pricking inside her, her energy reaching out to touch the little bits of powder, the acrid white burn of malt. "You have to push it," the thought came. "Just a little bit to make it bond correctly." The scholar's yelling wasn't helping her concentrate, of course.
"What in Kulsta's name do you mean by—"
She breathed in again, pressing the smells together in her mind, and the liquid warmed her palms through the glass, the crimson scent dimming to a sickly gold. Perfect. Better than perfect. Anwei uncorked the bottle and emptied the liquid over the scholar's head.
"You sky-cursed initiate's pin-nib of—"
The scholar lurched back from the desk, half trying to save his precious illumination, half scrabbling at his face as the concoction dripped down.
"Are you trying to destroy years of work on an irreplaceable—"
In her mind, she cheered the concoction on, and suddenly it snaked down his collar as if it were alive.
Anwei's breath caught, the energy inside her burning. She'd never seen the compound do that before. Grunting, the scholar fell face down onto his vellum. He lay there, gold paint smeared across his cheek, and a dribble of saliva beading on his lips to drip onto the page under his chin. Anwei blinked, fear like a rotten pit in her core. It had taken her whole soul to stop the Calistet from killing Knox down in the tomb. But this had just happened. She grabbed the little lamp sitting next to the fallen scholar on the floor, lit the wick with her own flint and steel, then ran through the doors to the restricted stacks a little too quickly. Books. I'm looking for books, pages, records about the estate that uses a snake housemark. The shelves were laid out in long rows that disappeared into the darkness, the air a dry, underground cold. Running into the first aisle, Anwei forced herself to calm, losing herself as she systematically checked for signs of the housemark. How much time did she have left? The guards outside wandered back to check on something about every 8 minutes based on her observations the day before, and knocking out the scholar hadn't been timed the right way. She had to hurry. The air somehow breathed thicker between the ancient shelves, the scents of dust, cured hide, ink, and mold strangling Anwei. The records are hidden down here, she whispered to herself as she moved on to the next set of shelves. He has scholars reporting on anyone who comes looking for them. I'll be able to see it, whatever it is. I have to. The family name. I remember the name they told me all those years ago. She crashed between bookshelves crowded together like old gossips at the well, searching for a section with property records. When she found the right aisle, Anwei recoiled, something foul twitching in her nose. There was a pot sitting in the middle of the aisle, its contents a slippery cinnamon red that reached for her, sticking in her lungs. Alchemy. In Castor's library? Excitement surged in Anwei's gut. Alchemy was hardly an accepted practice. Scholars wouldn't allow it down among their precious records, which meant that scholars hadn't put it there. Keeping watch on records that referred to Tuul's own history made sense to Anwei. A shapeshifter able to survive as long as he had to be monitoring who was asking questions about him and why. Anwei did the same herself, rewarding her contacts if they told her about anyone who came asking. But Alchemy and the restricted stacks themselves? Why bother? If the information was so dangerous he needed this kind of precaution, wouldn't he just destroy records? But then she smelled it. The awful scent of nothing that followed Tuul everywhere he went. The reek of stolen soul. She darted into the aisle, noting records about rogue devoted, basist collectives, crimes against children. All hidden in the dark to keep devoted from destroying them like they had every other record of basists, from temple donation ledgers to property sales, no doubt. According to what Leah had learned in Patanga's tomb, the centuries of attempting to cleanse basists of the nameless god's touch had been for nothing. It wasn't basists that were dangerous. It was bonded pairs of gods touched working together, the danger only coming when one betrayed the other. The scars marking Anwei's arms and legs, her collarbones and her back, began to burn at the thought. A rush of anger seemed to wait inside her all the time now, looking for the tiniest trigger to flood her humors. All these years, the devoted had been protecting the Commonwealth from shapeshifters, soul stealers, the creatures who made themselves gods, who stole energy from others instead of sacrificing for their own magic. Dirt witches. Basists. But the shapeshifter tomb in Cheol hadn't belonged to a basist. The shapeshifter king had been touched by Kalsta. Leah had seen the reliefs with her own eyes showing a devoted stabbing the man he loved most, a basist, to take his life and power. Any gods touched could become a shapeshifter so long as they were bonded with someone touched by a different god. A truth the first warlord had hidden, eradicating the threat of future shapeshifters by destroying the kind of magic that wasn't hers. You needed both a basist and a devoted to make a shapeshifter, so if basists were all dead, no new shapeshifters could emerge. Devoted still taught the horrible lies the first warlord had used to make herself the Commonwealth's new leader. If we don't destroy basists, they'll eat our souls. Anwei tripped, the clatter of a metal pot against stone ringing in her ears, and a bloom of something clouding up toward her face. Of all the ridiculous moments to get angry and stop looking properly for threats, Anwei jerked back, but it was too late. Her vision had begun to warp. No. She stumbled back, jamming a hand into her medicine bag, the smoke burrowing down her throat with ferocious glee that was too many colors. Her mind ticked through all the scents coming from her medicine bag, her fingers closing around a fistful of packets that would counter the poison before she... Anwei suddenly found herself staring at the wall, one hand deep inside her medicine bag and her mind blank. Lost in thought when Anwei only had 5 minutes at most to find the information that would lead her to the snake tooth man. Maybe I'll have better luck in the next aisle. Her legs shook as she squeezed between a gap in the shelves, her eyes settling on a pot. A pot? Hadn't she seen a pot a moment ago? It had seemed so important. She looked down at her hand inside the bag. One of her fingers was prickling with heat, knuckle deep in a packet of Baylor stamens, the acid eating into her skin. When she pulled it out, two other packets came with it. Ground P4 scales and dried husk nut shell cut into neat strips. Taking an experimental step forward, Anwei held out the lantern and saw a single chindril of smoke spilling over the pot's lip. The smell of it pleasant, like herbs and... The door at the entrance rattled, and Anwei jerked to life, her eyes tracing the same spot on the wall, her arms limp. She stumbled backward, the air around her no longer sweet. Light bled into the stacks, footsteps slapping against the stone. The guards must have found the incapacitated scholar. She was out of time. Turning back to the row she'd been searching, she saw a pot. A pot with a cloud of smoke pouring from it. Her hand was once again thrust deep into her medicine bag, herbs burning her fingers. This was the second time she'd tried to take them out, the taste of them a perfect answer to the smoke. Holding her breath, Anwei tore the scarf from her hair and twisted the herbs inside it. She shoved the scarf against her nose, then ran into the cloud of smoke so thick she couldn't see through it anymore. Her skin, her mind, every inch of her crawled with the feel of magic trying to worm its way back in through her ears, her eyes, her mouth. The herbs were there to stop someone, to delay them, to make sure they got caught. Perhaps O'Toole could come himself to find out who had gone to such lengths to find him. Anwei touched book after book, squinting at the spines, then going by feel until she stumbled over another pot. They were boxing in this section of shelf, belching smoke that roiled in poisonous waves, as if kicking over the first pot had triggered some kind of trap. Pressing the herbs tighter against her nose and mouth, Anwei turned back to search through the section again, gasping down a single lungful of herb-laced air. Lantern light flashed past her, the shouts close now. Anwei's lungs burned. She fell to her knees, pulling books from the shelves one after another. But she couldn't smell, not with the Alcancer smoke clouding around her head. Rage rose like a monster inside her. Anwei gulped down another orange-tinged breath through the scarf, lashing out toward the shelf where she'd smelled the nothing smell before, throwing all of the bound papers to the ground. None of it looked right. Property records, edicts, books of history. Anwei's eyes began to fuzz at the edge, making her wobble. She caught herself on the top shelf, and her fingers found leather. She pulled the object down, not a book, but a folio jammed tight with papers. A snake had been tooled into the leather. It had been pulled from the shelf and left open on top as if someone had recently been reading it but had forgotten mid-sentence why they would want to be down in this dark, awful cave. There was nothing down here worth her attention, just useless books. Grunting, Anwei wrenched herself free of the sticky thought and grabbed the folio in both hands. She took it and ran, upsetting the shelves behind her to stop the scholars from easily seeing what she'd taken. Shouts echoed up from all around her, closing in. She was surrounded. A guard stepped into the aisle just next to her, lantern held high. The smoke didn't seem to confuse him, and she had only a moment before he saw her over the tops of the books. Drawing in another poison-tinged breath, Anwei threw herself up against the shelf, groaning with effort until it tipped. Books began to fall with sickly thuds into the aisle on the other side of the shelf, the wooden joints creaking until the shelf fell to the ground with a terrible crash of old leather and fluttering paper on top of the guard. Figures appeared at both ends of the aisle, guards cautiously approaching. "Do not move," one shouted, only 30 paces between them. Thrusting the folio into her bag, Anwei's fingers closed around the Calistet packet with its distinctive button. Flashes of Knox on the ground, of powder in the air, of energy being violently sucked out of her chest, the herbs burning in the air right before her eyes. The snake-tooth man holding Knox's sword. "Grab her," the guard shouted. Anwei let go of the packet and grabbed the one filled with ground corda instead, sprinting for the pot billowing with smoke. Hands grabbed for her robe, but Anwei skidded down onto her knees, tore open the packet, and emptied half of it into the gushing smoke. Arms grabbed her around the ribs, lifting her off the ground, but Anwei had already twisted to grind the last of the orange powder directly into the guard's nose and mouth. Jerking back, he let go of Anwei, scrubbing his eyes with his hands. Stumbling away from him, Anwei found the strength to run. She scooped up the pot as she passed it, corda granules bonding with the elements in the smoke to turn a sickly, toxic red where it tried to push past the herbs protecting her breath. It made a cloak around her as she ran, any guards who came close clutching their throats and retching. I said 10 minutes. The herbs in her scarf were fading. One last breath, all Anwei could gasp down. The weight of the folio seemed to drag against her shoulder, but Anwei was full of sunlight, of hope, excitement, and vengeance, even as the smoke swirled out to catch another guard in the face. Whatever was in that folio, it was going to change everything. It had to. Down the last aisle, up the stairs, through the door, smoke churning around her like a storm cloud. Past the desk and the scholar just beginning to blink his eyes open, and onto the grumpy man in the picture window to whom Anwei gave a cheeky salute. But as she crossed into the main library, something in Anwei's mind gave a sharp twist. Anwei stumbled past two guards keeping people out of the restricted stacks, clutching the pot around the belly as she tried to find her balance. Her thoughts contracted around the spot at the back of her mind that was tied to Knox. A lightning burst cracked out from Knox's consciousness, and Anwei gasped, pitching forward onto her knees. And then the pain was gone, leaving only Knox there, the warm touch of him pointing her back toward the camp. He was awake. Fists grabbed hold of her robe, wrenching her up from the ground. Anwei smashed the pot into the guard's head. The contents swirled up into the air in a poisonous cinnabar sparkle. He let go of her, stumbling back even as Anwei gagged, a mouthful of poison and corda and only the nameless god knew what else was in that pot going down her throat. Unwrapping the herbs tied into her scarf, Anwei shoved them directly into her mouth, the taste of them burning her tongue. She lurched past the stacks and the frozen scholars shouting with confusion, the herbs turning the angry red of the smoke to a breeze of yellows and blues. Shaking, she crashed through the door that opened onto the main steps, chanting scholars crying out with surprise as she stumbled through their midst, then heaved herself into a wagon full of palafruit. The driver turned to shout at her, but Anwei wasn't listening, hopping out again once the guards had raced past. She rushed down the next few streets toward where Alton and Noah were waiting. Knox was awake. The thought sent a nauseating swirl of relief, excitement, and worry through Anwei's humors. But there was fear as well. Because if Knox was awake, then that meant Willow was too. Chapter 3. The Wrong Kind of Veil. Leah sat under a tree with Vivi's head in her lap. Her veil pressed tight against her nose and chin, the front of it trapped under the Eroche's pointed snout. The crisp morning air prickled like needles across Leah's skin, despite the thin veil fabric Noah had bought for her in the market. It covered her face, hair, and shoulders, shrouding her to the waist. Gold threads sewn through it teased light into her peripheral vision. Noah's interpretation of what plain fabric meant was different from any other person Leah had ever met. Her hands worked fast on Vivi's mane, tying knot after fancy knot. It didn't matter. Not the gold thread, not the braids, not anything. Leah could hardly see, her eyes glazed over with the last word she'd gotten from Toole Montagna, a note left on her front gate while her home burned with her parents inside.
Your sister misses you.
Please.
She thought it toward the sky goddess, stripes of pain across her ungloved hands as she pulled Vivi's coarse hair tight.
Please, I've been wearing this veil for weeks. You know what I want.
That was the problem. Oaths weren't supposed to be about what people wanted, but rather what the gods who touched them did. Leah had her aura sight, her first oath to Kalsta restored in Cheol. It had been a relief, Kalsta's power flowing through her despite the fact that she'd run away from the devoted. The power that came from keeping her second oath, to own only things necessary to survive, had returned that morning, letting her see farther and hear better than she was supposed to. But she was still diminished. The goddess had yet to return Leah's strength, her ability to push against gravity and hide in broad daylight. It was a difficult oath to keep, the third one, to love only the goddess. And the oaths that a veil and gloves should have brought back, the ability to track auras no matter where she was, and her view into people's thoughts and feelings, felt even more impossible.
Only you can stop him. You and Anwei and Knox.
The memory of Kalsta's voice burned through Leah, the devoted thinking that for once she and Kalsta had the same goal. As soon as the thought came, Leah sent it away again, batting at it like a pesky bee intent on stinging her. The goddess had never been against her in the first place. That had been the masters, the seclusions, the warlord, speaking for Kalsta as if she had any right. Kalsta didn't require those she touched to make devoted oaths, didn't even require devoted to hold those oaths their whole lives. It was the warlord who had turned oaths into a prison Leah couldn't bear. Choosing to make oaths in exchange for power was easier than being forced to make them. But deep inside, Leah knew that she was following Toole because she wanted to save Arya, not because the goddess had told her to. Leah wiped a hand across her forehead, annoyed when her palm met fabric instead of skin, smearing a trickle of sweat dripping down her temple.
she'd chosen to wear the veil. Choosing to do as Kalsta said was loving the goddess more than anyone else. Kalsta had told her to destroy Tuol. That was what she was doing. It didn't matter that Arya would be safe as a result, too. Did it? She had to believe Kalsta would see her sacrifice and reward it. But she'd put on the veil weeks ago, and her powers hadn't returned. Frustration bubbled in Leah's gut, her hand shaking because she had to do something or it would boil over. She couldn't wear the gloves, too. Couldn't. The veil was hard enough. Surely Kalsta could see that. They both wanted the same thing, so why wouldn't Kalsta give her the tools she needed to destroy Tuol Montaigne and save Arya? Knox's aura gave a sleepy churn inside the tent. Leah went absolutely still, focusing on the change. Vivi's hackles rose, a low growl scratching from his throat. We can't leave Knox alone, Anwei had whispered to Leah their first day on the road, far from where Alton might overhear. You saw what happened in the tomb. Indeed, she had. Leah reached out to touch the sword in the grass next to her, the tightness in her chest loosening only a hair when her fingers found metal. Finally, she had a weapon again. Borrowed, of course. Apparently, Trib clans respected the warlord's decree that only devoted could carry swords in the Commonwealth, but only so far as stashing their weapons where devoted wouldn't see them. Having a proper weapon felt like the beginning of doing something. Knox had come at her with a sword down in Patanga's tomb, teeth bared, his eyes stretched too wide, trying to fight right through her as if she were a wall between him and Anwei. Tuol Montaigne had much to answer for. Along with murdering her parents and kidnapping her sister, it was he who had killed Knox's sister and trapped the girl's soul inside a shapeshifter sword. Knox had been carrying her ghost around, letting her feed off his energy ever since. And apparently, sometimes the ghost took him, mind, body, and soul, leaving nothing behind but an appetite for death. Vivi's eyes slid open, inky black staring up at her with reproach. Leah pulled her hand away from the sword to loosen the strands of hair she'd been tightly knotting and smoothed the hand down his serpentine neck. Sorry, she whispered. I didn't mean to hurt you. He let his eye drift shut, mollified. Leah envied the way Vivi had settled into an unyielding calm, as if tromping through the undersides of the Commonwealth was all he ever could have wanted so long as she was on his back. As if Leah disappearing and Ewan bonding with him had never... Putting a hand to her head, Leah clenched her eyes shut. Ewan. His blood watered a shapeshifter's tomb, his body food for scavengers. No matter how many times she thought of him limp on the ground, unable to hurt her anymore, the memory of him alive was twice as strong. His awful leer, his groping hands. Only now, in her mind, his face had been replaced with Tuol's. Ewan had only wanted her body. Tuol wanted her soul. Standing, Leah fumbled with shaking hands to tie back her veil, then picked up the sword. Vivi bared his teeth from the ground in what passed for an Arosh laugh as she set her feet into a fighting stance, gripping the sword with both hands. I'm rusty, she whispered to him. They wouldn't let me touch a weapon while I was under the veil. He snaked his head across the grass, rolling onto his back with his forefeet curled to his chest as if he meant to play like a dog. You want to put me through my paces? She slid from the first stance to the second, the sword high over her head. The thought of Arya shimmered through her. Her humors burned, each step coming faster and harder. The fan sweep, the lunge and parry, the... Something in the tent moved.
Vivi gave a low squeal, rolling over abruptly to stare at the tent. Turning slowly to face the heavy flap, Leah let her sword tip drop. Her aura sight circled the tight globe of energy that marked Knox, swirls like mist beginning to roil inside it. He was waking up. Brow furrowing, Leah advanced on the tent, her veil blowing back against her face as she walked, the sword heavy in her hand. Knox had only stirred a few times since the night Tool had killed him and Anwei had, well, she'd done something. The skin prickled across Leah's arms as she took another step toward the waving tent flap, thinking of that night. A swirl of basest power around Anwei like a brazen call to war. But Leah fought to put that thought away. It wasn't basest magic itself that was bad. Mateo had shown her that. An insight that still twitched uncomfortably inside Leah. She'd killed people for their purple God's touched auras. The fact of it sat deep in her gut like a knife that would cut at the slightest movement. Mateo had made the argument that basism was no better than Kalsta's touch and that no one kind of magic should be banned. That anyone with power could do evil. It wasn't the power itself that was wrong. It had made sense when he said it, and then Anwei had proved it, using the nameless god's touch to save Knox's life. But then Mateo had turned out to be a shapeshifter. Those first few days, Leah had wanted to pretend it wasn't possible. She'd even brought it up with Anwei.
He didn't do it. Whatever you're so angry about, it had to have been Tool. Mateo didn't know he was a shapeshifter. He doesn't remember he's your brother. I don't think he remembers you at all.
Anwei had stopped when Leah had said that, a well of pure fury sparking in her eyes. The thief hadn't said another word for the rest of the day.
He doesn't remember you.
He didn't remember Leah either, it seemed. That was a better explanation than the one that was most likely, after weeks of her sister gone and no word. Leah drew back the tent flap and found Knox sitting up, hand to his head. His aura was clouded white instead of gold. His bond with Anwei somehow blocking Kalsta's touch from Leah's aura sight. Knox swiveled to look at her, his voice croaking.
Leah?
He blinked at the veil.
You're sparkly.
Leah dropped her sword, falling to her knees next to Knox on the pallet to wrap her arms around him. The breath wafted out of him because she was squeezing his ribs too hard, but his arms circled her, pulling her close. Leah's eyes began to burn, and she couldn't let go.
I am so, so happy you are awake, she rasped.
If Knox wasn't some ghost, then maybe Arya wasn't her only family left. He'd help face down Tuol Montagna. Leah pulled back far enough to look Knox up and down, eyes stopping on the bulge of bandaging just under his ribs where Tuol had stabbed him.
You sound like yourself. Are you all right?
Why wouldn't I be myself?
Knox's hand crept up to touch the bandage. He closed his eyes, concentrating.
Where's Anwei? She's...
He looked east, toward Rintara.
Not here.
The words came out abruptly, Leah not knowing what to say. His oaths were still intact, even as he held Anwei's name in his mouth as if it belonged to him. Feelings off limits for a devoted.
What happened?
Knox twisted back toward her.
I was in town, and that cranky, awful woman threw my sword at me.
Gulia?
The old apothecarist he and Anwei had lived with back in Cheol. Anwei hadn't been able to understand how Knox had come by the dangerous sword again after she'd hidden it. Apparently, Gulia had found it.
You don't remember anything else?
Pressing his lips together, Knox looked down, letting Leah go. He did remember something.
When did you say Anwei was coming back? She's all right?
He put a hand up to his forehead.
Where are we? Whose tent is this? Why are you wearing a veil? I thought you weren't going back to the devoted.
Leah paused at the sound of footsteps approaching the tent, an aura she recognized from Alton's riders approaching. She pulled her veil back down over her face.
That is a lot of questions.
Knox was already looking toward the flap before a voice called from outside.
No, Knox was definitely not diminished. Miss Leah.
In here,
she called. It was Gilesh, the one with calluses from the fiddle he played while others drummed and sang around the campfire. Leah knew him best because he was the only one who didn't stare at her veil, speaking to her and joking as if she were anyone else. He'd even laughed at her when she'd asked if they played music around the fire every night, only because she'd never heard people playing music except from a distance. Music and dancing, both too trivial for a devoted. She'd liked the feel of it, those drums beating alongside her heart and her chest. Kalsta hadn't seemed to mind either. Galesh's hand pushed the tent flap in. He froze when he found Knox and Leah both staring in his direction.
Sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt.
You're not interrupting,
she said coolly, standing to face him.
Did you need something?
Your friend is feeling better? Those stories they tell about Baelden healers really are true, aren't they?
Galesh's eyebrows quirked when neither of them responded.
I came over to ask if you might finally let me cross blades with you. I saw you doing forms a moment ago, and Bane said—
You don't want to fight with Leah, Knox interrupted.
I mean, I think I do, he grinned. It's not just Baeldens I've heard stories about, but if I'm honest, the ones about devoted are a little harder to believe.
Knox blinked.
Who is this?
He asked carefully.
I need to oil my cuirass and leathers. I wouldn't be surprised if we ride out this afternoon.
Leah stood, hoping Galesh would take it as an invitation to go.
I'll come by the armorer's tent in a bit, once I'm sure Knox is settled.
That a yes?
Galesh leaned forward, a gold-capped tooth flashing in his grin. Anwei had noticed it the same day they'd left Cheol and had stopped the whole caravan to check what was under it. Somehow. With her magic? Her sense of smell, perhaps? Trib clans didn't use house marks, but Anwei didn't care what people usually did or didn't do.
Don't say anything.
Galesh was grinning so wide he could hardly talk.
Bane will persuade you. You can't hide from us all the time, either one of you. You're devoted too, aren't you?
He looked eagerly toward Knox, though Knox looked nothing of the kind, thinned out and rangy, hollows in his cheeks and shadows under his eyes.
We'll let you recover before we push you into the training yards. Quite a wound you took, wasn't it? One of us untouched wouldn't have lived to see the other side of it.
Knox's hand went back to the bandages under his tunic.
Right.
Galesh glanced once more between them both.
Well, you're both being incredibly awkward, so I'll see you over there?
He grinned, waiting for Leah to respond, but she wasn't sure what she was supposed to say. Nobody ever spoke to devoted that way. No one except Mateo, who had almost seemed like he wanted someone to end his life before it ended all on its own. So she tried smiling back. That's what Anwei and Noah both did. Anwei's smile ever charming and helpless. Noah's cutting like wire.
Sure, I'll show you which stories about devoted are true.
Of course, he couldn't see her face through the veil, she realized. It didn't seem to matter. Galesh nodded eagerly.
I could show you a thing or two about trib forms. Different style.
He took a step toward them.
Very aggressive.
I'm sure they are.
Vexation simmered out through Leah's arms to her fingertips. She itched to grab hold of her sword. she did want to fight. Fighting had always dulled the pain. It was hard to remember how unhappy you were when you were sparring in a training yard or fighting for your life on the road. Nothing but a saddle, a sword, and a goal to accomplish. Galesh wouldn't put up that kind of fight. She'd have to pull her strikes, go slow, lead him through forms like fighting trainees so new they could still remember the taste of sugar. Leah swallowed the choking feeling of Aria, trying to replace it with Knox awake. Soon, Anwei would be back with the key to bringing Tuol down, she'd said. But it wasn't enough to feed breath back into Leah's lungs as she tried to answer Galesh.
Devoted forms are pretty aggressive, too. I've broken more than one opponent's sword.
Sure, sure.
Galesh leaned toward Knox, lowering his voice.
We find the Commonwealth's tiniest devoted, and somehow she still thinks she can take me.
Turning, he walked out, giving them both a careless wave, though Leah didn't miss his flinch when Vivi snarled in his direction. Knox's mouth hung open.
Where in Kalsta's name are we?
A 10-minute ride outside Rentara, tracking Tuol Montagna, Anwei's snake-tooth man.
With a Trib clan?
Weren't you working with Alton before we went into the tomb? Anwei said he paid you to steal Patanga's sword.
The pineapple?
Knox's brow creased.
Pineapple?
Leah crouched next to him, impatience swelling in her chest like pus under a wound. Vivi trilled from outside as if he could feel it too through their bond. Knox didn't seem to be a danger to anyone, though she wasn't sure he was in his right mind.
Maybe you should rest. Wait until Anwei gets back to check you over before we get into everything. She should be here soon.
Shaking his head, Knox pushed the blankets off his legs.
No, if you're going to go fight some cocky Trib, there's no way I'm missing it. Are you going to do it in a veil, though?
Leah looked down at herself. The light travel leathers and comfortable trousers Noah had been absolutely certain were too plain, starkly contrasting to the floaty veil.
I need Kalsta to be with me,
she whispered.
Why?
Knox reached out to pick up her sword from the ground, but then didn't touch it, staring at the length of the blade with a grim sort of revulsion.
You aren't wearing gloves, and you hugged me just now. We both know oaths take time, and you're still diminished far below that veil. Plus, you hate wearing it.
Because Tuol has my sister, Knox.
Leah leaned forward to pick up the sword herself.
It doesn't matter how much I hate wearing a veil. I need Kalsta. I'll need everything she can give me to face him. You were too hurt to see.
Knox flinched, his hand going to the bandage again. Maybe he had seen some of it.
You can do whatever you want.
He reached out to touch her arm.
We both know Kalsta doesn't see oaths as penance. She doesn't exchange pain for power, so torturing yourself isn't going to make anything go faster.
Frustration erupted inside Leah like an army of ants.
I have to do something, Knox! I have to fight! Wearing this?
She tugged the end of the veil.
You don't have to explain yourself to me,
Knox said quietly when she trailed off. He had always been quiet, but it was a different sort of quiet now, one that didn't wait. He was not quite the boy she'd grown up with. Leah didn't like the idea of him changing, though she'd changed enough for the both of them. He looked up at her.
You want to fight? Let's fight.
You just woke up.
I'm fine.
He held out a hand for her to pull him up.
You're not fine. Let's do this, you and me.
You and me?
Leah's insides melted, tears pricking in her eyes because Knox knew her. He knew.
Like old times.
It was the wrong thing to do, helping Knox up from the ground. Like Mateo had said that day, they looked at the painting of the nameless god and Kalsta reaching for each other. It was not who you were or which god chose you. It was what you chose. She knew it was wrong to lead Knox out of the tent toward the dry bit of ground the Trib used to spar. She knew he was sick. Knew Anwei was worried something inside him would snap, and then Knox would be gone. But Anwei wasn't here. He seemed normal. Familiar. The one person who knew Leah before she'd followed a shapeshifter and gotten her whole family killed. Leah needed familiar. She needed her sword. So, when Knox followed her out of the tent, she didn't argue. Chapter 4. An Untouchable Weapon. Knox stepped out of the tent after Leah, his mind buzzing with fresh air and light and words and life, as if he hadn't been unconscious long enough to get halfway across the country. Anwei pulsed at the back of his mind like a cord tethering him to the earth. And Willow. He felt around inside his mind, looking for her shadow. But Anwei's presence there was too strong. Willow was gone. Knox ran a few steps to catch up with Leah.
Do you know what happened to my sword?
Leah pressed fingers to her mouth through her veil and blew a kiss toward Vivi lying under a tree a ways away from the tent. In return, the thing threw back its head in a feral scream that was all teeth and quivering gullet. Anwei must have told Leah about the sword, about Willow, and... Knox's mind flashed back to the last thing he truly remembered. Gulia slamming the pockmarked hilt of the cursed sword into his chest. After that, there were only shaky blasts of memory, of pain, of darkness, of a boy his age collapsed on the floor nearby. Willow shriveling inside him, claw deep in whatever kept him alive as she dragged him to oblivion with her. And Anwei's hands, her energy burning bright as it flooded him, Kalsta's voice telling him to reach for her.
The sword melted.
Leah's voice was quiet. I don't know what Anwei did with it, but it's gone. Knox breathed in slow, then out. Did that mean Willow was free? Released from her rotting prison to go in peace? That was all he'd ever wanted. All I ever wanted. The thought sat in his head, catching on every syllable. Because there were new things he wanted now. The memory of Kalsta's voice whispered through him. A bond, she'd said. What had happened between him and Anwei? The link that had joined their minds was a magical bond. One that fit within the framework of devotion. There were more oaths to make, Kalsta had said, and saving Willow from the sword had hinged upon it. But Willow was gone.
It is not finished, Knox,
Kalsta's voice whispered through him.
You are not free of her.
Of who? Anwei?
Your sister is not gone. Anwei is keeping her from taking control of you. But Willow found the other half of her corrupted bond, and she likes him better than you.
Knox?
Leah had led him to a large circle of open ground past the tents, where the weeds had been stamped to bare dirt. Three Tribs sat on old stumps next to it, strumming mandolins, taking turns picking out melodies and laughing at one another when they hit wrong notes.
Are you all right?
Leah's voice was tight, aura sparks glittering and skipping around her head like a crown. That was Leah. She'd always gathered up all the feelings she wasn't allowed to have and turned them into energy almost as if she were a goddess herself.
I'm fine, he said.
You're moving slowly. Is it your wound? Kalsta above, she swore. I shouldn't have let you get up.
No.
Knox's hand went to his side. A hard knot sat just under his ribs, which he'd felt when he first sat up, but hadn't been sure what it was or how it came to be. It pulled on him as he walked, as if everything inside him was 2 or 3 degrees crooked.
I'm just trying to remember everything.
He wanted Anwei to come back. She'd given up something. He could feel it. She'd made some oath, sacrificed something to save him from whatever had happened in the tomb. And it had solidified the bond between them.
She's frightened of you.
Kalsta's voice was scorching.
Frightened?
Knox's fingers dug into the knot under his ribs before he could stop himself, flashes of Anwei's long braids in his face. Anwei threatening to spike his tea. Anwei's rosebud mouth turned up in a smile. Anwei limp in his arms as he ran toward the gate in the tomb compound, and Anwei's skin traced over in scars.
She was angry at me, but that's not the same thing. Did Willow do something?
Yes, Willow tried to kill her again, but that's not what I mean. Anwei is frightened of you.
Knox rolled his eyes. Kalsta was in fine form, as always. Anwei had sworn at him, teased him, confronted him when Willow's sword was in his hand, even yelled at him the night he'd told her about Kalsta's oaths. But there was no way Anwei was afraid of him. He wasn't afraid of Anwei either, but Knox couldn't say that to Kalsta. He didn't even know what he was allowed to say to the goddess anymore. Only that everything inside him that was twisted together with Anwei wasn't something he could step back from, even if he wanted to. Which, in this moment of clarity, he very much did not want to.
You think I can't hear every one of those little thoughts darting through your little mind, Knox?
Knox shrugged away Kalsta's amusement, then tensed as the trib who'd come into the tent earlier appeared from what looked like a supply shelter erected next to the training field. Several others followed him out of the enclosure. Leah grabbed hold of her veil and pulled it off so quickly that it was over before Knox knew it was happening. Leah a mass of spangled white one moment and a snarl of red curls and freckles the next.
Miss Leah, your face,
the trib faltered. My veil isn't sewn on, Galesh, Leah informed him. You thought I was hiding something, right? Maybe a missing nose? Another of the trib, much taller and with bangs that hung in his eyes, elbowed Galesh.
I mean, we didn't take bets or anything, Miss Leah.
Well, make them now, Bane. Leah let her veil drop to the grass. And get Knox a sword.
No.
Knox's stomach jolted, his palms suddenly sweaty.
Not a sword. Anything else would be fine. I thought we were going to spar,
Galesh pouted. It wouldn't be fair to you. She pushed past him, going into the tent. Riders began to fill in around the field, coming to see what the hullabaloo was about. They crowded in behind Knox, pushing one another and yelling out taunts toward Galesh. Knox ran an eye over the growing company, struggling to find a pattern to who carried what. Knives, spears, axes, even one with a pair of bronze maces large enough to punch through plate armor. Leah emerged from the tent holding her sword in one hand and a long quarterstaff in the other. She pointed it at him.
Are you feeling the least bit ill? Lightheaded? Tired?
Knox wrenched the staff away from her for an answer. He ran into the circle of packed dirt, holding his arms wide toward Leah in a challenge. Leah obviously needed a good spar, to sweat until she was tired enough to forget for a few minutes. But suddenly, he wanted it for himself, too. He was awake, full of energy, full of life, instead of full of a ghost. He felt like himself, instead of whatever the sword had made of him.
Willow's not gone, Knox.
Kalsta's reminder burned, But Knox didn't want to hear it, didn't want to believe it with all this energy rushing through him and the sky clear.
He's been on his back for a month.
Galesh stepped toward Leah, hand on his weapon.
She probably doesn't want to hurt any of your riders, Knox called back.
He racked his brain for the Trib leader's name, the one who had managed to infiltrate the apothecary back in Sheol, then had spent his time there lying on the floor across from Anwei making explosives, as if they'd been playing marbles.
Alton won't like it if she starts picking you off.
You think Miss Leah won't hurt you?
Galesh's smile had spread into a grin.
Or you think the Kenyatta would rather she hurt you than me?
The second one.
Knox leaned on the quarterstaff like a cane. He was still confused as to how they'd landed in a circle of Trib with Alton at their head. That sneak had pretended to help them back in Sheol, only to escape with all the information they'd gathered in order to break into the tomb.
Are you going to come out here or not, Leah?
Leah walked deliberately into the circle, keeping her sword point low. Everything went quiet. Not the Trib, who had begun shouting from the edges of the circle, but Knox's mind as he breathed in, centering himself. His muscles felt soft, weak, but when he closed his eyes, Kalsta's well of power was there inside him, waiting to be drawn. Leah was too diminished to have her strength back, so at least that made them somewhat even. Lifting the quarterstaff, Knox took half a step toward Leah, glorying in the familiar calm he'd learned at the seclusions. He wasn't a thief desperately trying to hide from his past, not a tool in Kalsta's hands, and he wasn't the puppet that Willow had made of him. A shard of ice came winging through his thoughts, quick like a startled bird and gone in a blink as it glanced off the barrier that Anwei and Kalsta had made in his head. Knox's side began to throb, the hairs on the back of his neck prickling. Willow was still there. Knox breathed in, trying to negate the background hiss she made inside him.
Go free, Willow. What do you want with me in this world?
The thoughts came in desperate gasps, the dark presence gathering thicker like a storm over the wall of magic protecting him.
The sword is gone. Just go.
Leah settled into her stance across from Knox, letting the tip of her sword hover just above the dirt. Her cheeks had gone pink, her eyes flicking between him and his quarterstaff, and Knox could see that she needed to swing that sword into something, and it didn't matter who or what. A screech rang out over the camp, followed by a long, shuddering Arosh squeal, as if Vivi could feel her agitation and couldn't stand to be left out of the fun. The goose flesh down Knox's arms spread up his neck, his palms beginning to sweat, and a flash of unease stirred in his gut. By now, it seemed the whole camp had gathered to catcall and cheer. Galesh and Bane tried to begin a synchronized clap, but it didn't catch. Leah's eyes ticked toward the sound, and in her moment of distraction, Knox threw himself forward, Kalsta's energy singing through him as he slammed the quarterstaff down onto Leah's shoulder. It should have broken her collarbone. With a sword, it would have slit her from shoulder to navel, but Leah's sword was up before he got close, batting the quarterstaff away like a fly. Knox twisted in midair, fending off Leah's return stab. When he landed, the riders were suddenly all very, very quiet. Leah hesitated a second, as if to somehow acknowledge Knox's days abed. But then she was a wildfire. Stab after stab, swipe after swipe, Knox blocking and spinning, trying to fit in his attacks toward her feet, then her arms, then her head. But she blocked each one, coming faster and faster until her frown was gone and she was nothing but energy. Each attack came stronger, Knox drawing in more of Kalsta's energy to compensate for his leaden feet, the way he seemed to stick to the ground,
turned too slow, and blocked a hair too long before returning an attack. Swipe, spin, stab, moving forward and backward and around until Leah spun up into the air, a kick swiping toward his face. Then the full momentum of her sword slamming into the center of his quarterstaff when he blocked, slicing it in two. Knox retreated, fending off her continued attack with the two severed pieces like twin swords. But then Leah hacked the one in his left hand in two and batted away the second when he threw it at her chest like a spear.
Hey, over here!
One of the riders held a mace out toward Knox. Knox rolled to the side to avoid another swipe from Leah's sword, jumping up to catch the mace when the man threw it, barely bringing it up in time to block Leah's sword. Her eyes were wild, her teeth bared, and there was nothing in her but fight. Like so many years in training, with every frustration, every moment of anger and homesickness, Leah bled it dry on the practice field. This felt different, though, as if every blow, every form, every jump only stoked the raging bonfire inside her. She was raw, out of control, and she was coming for him. Kulsta, help me, he swore, only to have the goddess laugh.
In this fight, why?
Leah leapt into a roll, her sword swiping a perfect arc toward his legs, forcing Knox to veer out of the way. He swung the mace toward her head, but Leah neatly slid beneath it, attacking with a barrage of kicks and stabs that left Knox off center, forcing him to retreat toward the edge of the circle. The mace was too heavy to easily block her quick blows, and Knox felt as if he were moving in slow motion. The last swipe at him coming from underneath as Leah slipped inside his guard yet again. Turning the close proximity to his advantage, Knox landed a blow just above Leah's sword hilt, knocking the weapon from her hands. Leah swore, slamming the palm of her hand into Knox's chin, then an elbow into his side, finishing with a cut toward Knox's windpipe that forced him to drop the mace so he could block her arm. She slithered away from him, kicking her sword up into the air, the point coming toward her instead of the hilt. Whipping off her coat, she caught the sword by its point with the fabric protecting her and swung the hilt toward Knox's head. He dodged, the split second he was on defense giving Leah an opening to flip the weapon up in the air and snag it by the hilt.
Knox, over here!
Knox barely had time to wonder how the Trib knew his name before two objects were hurtling toward him. He jumped up to catch the first projectile, then spun low to grab the second. Trib knives. They were too short to be much good against a sword, and Leah was rushing him, a feral scream on her lips. Vivi was screaming too, almost as if he were in pain. Knox threw the first knife low, then the second one high, but Leah managed to strike the first one out of the air with her sword, then went down into a split to catch the second, sending it right back to him. He swerved, and it flew into the swollen crowd of Trib, curses and laughter billowing out from their midst.
Leah!
Knox yelled, ducking a blow from the sword. He whacked the flat of the sword away with his arm and grabbed her wrist.
Leah, you're going to hurt someone!
She didn't seem to hear, clocking him in the stomach with the sword hilt just above the knot under his ribs. Pain arcing through him, Knox stumbled back. Another yell from the crowd. They were laughing, as if they couldn't see that she had completely lost control.
Here,
someone called, and another weapon was in the air. Knox lurched forward to catch it, spinning to face Leah before he realized that the weapon clutched in his hands was a sword. His mind seemed to blink out, his arms and hands adjusting automatically to the weight, the familiarity, the horror. Willow's shadow reared up inside him. He dropped it like a hot poker.
Knox!
Anwei's voice was suddenly there. He hadn't felt her return, his attention all on Leah.
Knox, move!
Leah's sword was swiping toward his throat. Knox could see it all unfolding,
The world slowed to a snail's crawl as Kalsta's energy flooded him. He could count the grass blades, hear each one as they whispered against one another in the wind, feel the shape of each word issuing from the crowd, the swish of leaves in the trees, Vivi's panicked stamping, birds' wings overhead, and his sword on the ground.
Knox!
Knox dropped down, jamming a fist into Leah's biceps, his second blow knifing into her wrist. The sword spun out of her hands and landed on the grass. She stood there, chest heaving, tears trailing down her cheeks. She looked at Knox, then Anwei, who was standing inside the ring of onlookers, the hubbub of laughter and jeering rising every second. Wiping the tears from her cheeks, Leah pushed past Knox into the crowd, the rider's catcalls dying in awkward yowls at the sight of her tear-stained face.
"We're leaving,"
Alton's voice rang out over the noise.
"Tents down and saddles up in the next hour. Leah."
Knox took a step after Leah, but the sound of his voice spurred her faster. So he turned toward Anwei instead, her energy sparking in his head. Riders were flooding the training circle, the sea of mirth and backslapping dimming to a background hum. Then Anwei pushed into sight. Knox's insides lurched. There were circles under her eyes, her braids were all askew, and there were blotches of red that smelled like herbs across her face and neck. She seemed helpless somehow, staring up at him as if the world had stopped. Anwei wasn't helpless. She'd never been helpless. But the feeling made a hole inside him, stealing his breath and tightening his chest. The bond between them was electric. Anwei felt helpless, and so he was feeling it too. Helpless and afraid.
"You're here,"
he breathed. There were tears.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.